Hello, my name is Bill Fagan, and I'm going to do my presentation on welding and artists who weld. So what are the main welding processes the artists would use? There's lots of different welding processes, and I picked three of them that I'm familiar with that the artists would use. The first one is TIG welding, tungsten and air gas welding. The second one is arc welding, and the third one is oxyacetylene welding. Now, I'm sorry about the pictures here, but I have to talk about PPE, which is personal protection equipment, because if you're going to do any welding, you have to protect yourself. There's a picture over there where a guy got his hand burned, and obviously he wasn't wearing gloves. And this person here got their neck burned because they didn't have their overalls on, the special overalls that you can put on, they're fireproof. They got burned because you can see this guy over here, he's welding, and when someone welds, they create an electrical arc, and this arc emits a lot of different types of ultraviolet light, radiation, and x-ray. So they will burn you if you don't cover yourself up. And there's a poor unfortunate person who got a piece of metal in his eye because he didn't have his goggles on. I'm sorry I have to show you this because it's quite important. So from your head to your toe, you have to have a welding mask, you have to have gloves for your hands, fireproof overalls, eye protective glasses, and steel and safety shoes for your toes because there's metal and there's fires and there's fumes, and you have to have an extractor. That's an extractor there that would extract noxious or poisonous fumes that are emitted from the welding processes. And obviously earmuffs, because your ears have to be protected as well. So I'm just going to talk briefly about these three processes and just to touch on them. So oxy and acetylene welding, basically it's a combination of two gases. The red one here is the combustible gas, it's acetylene, and the oxygen is oxygen. The oxygen will fuel the combustion of the two gases when they're mixed. And these cylinders are under tremendous pressure. The oxygen is compressed at 2,000 per square inch and 600 per square inch for the acetylene. So these gases want to get out, and the only way they can get out is to the top, where you have two regulators. And the regulators there will tell you the content of what's in the bottle, and it'll tell you the working pressure that you're going to use when you put your welding torch on. And basically what happens is the two gases go into the mixing chamber in the torch. It's ignited at the end of the torch, and the temperatures can reach up to 1,000 degrees. And I actually brought in, just to show you, that's the nozzle that would go on, if you want to have a look at that, on the end of the, you can pass that around, on the end of the torch there, it's made of copper. And there's a guy there welding, and he should be sacked. The reason why is that he's got no gas, he's no mask on, he's no earmuffs, he's no extraction, and he's smoking a cigarette, he can blow himself up. And then I've gone on to do arc welding. Arc welding, that would be mainly used in shipbuilding and building bridges and wherever. Artists would use arc welding as well. And it's totally different from the oxyacetylene welding because the power source is electricity, it's not gas. So the electricity will come in from your electrical grid. It will come into this machine here. It will travel down these two leads here. One is a return lead or an arc lead. And the other one is an electrode holder, which holds this electrode. So this electrode is a consumable electrode. That's one there. And it's basically a piece of wire. And on the wire is this flux. And when you initiate the arc, that's when you strike the arc where this big bright light, you have your mask on. What happens is the welding rod consumes itself. It's been used up. But as it's been consuming itself, it forms the slag over the molten weld, and this protects the weld from the atmosphere, because in the atmosphere there's nitrogen, oxygen, heat, there's loads of inclusions that will go into the weld, so this is to protect the weld. I know what you're saying, what's this to do with art? I'm getting to it. And then I'm going on to TIG welding. which is another, it's TIG welding, and it's a tungsten inert gas welding. And what that means is that you don't have this consumable electrode. What you have is this electrode here that's in the torch there that's doing the welding. It's called a non-consumable electrode, and it's made of tungsten. And the tungsten tip, its melting point is far higher than what it's going to weld. So therefore, it doesn't consume itself. You can use it again and again and again. And instead of using this flux on the weld, you use this gas, which is called argon. And the argon gas is an inert gas, which means that it doesn't react with whatever that it's going into the weld. It actually protects the weld. So that is tungsten inert gas welding.
Where would it go?
Yeah. So they use tungsten inert gas welding. And I forgot to say that I worked in the aircraft industry for a lot of years, and I did a lot of welding. And you probably hear in art, they'll say that oil is king. It's the king medium to work in. If you're a welder, the best welding you can do is with tungsten air gas welding, because it's so versatile. And it can weld materials such as aluminium, titanium, and magnesium, copper. It goes on and on and on.
Where am I now?
Oh, yeah. So, why it pays to be a welder and an artist. This is Kevin Stone's work here. It's a Chinese imperial water dragon, and it slowly takes shape in a studio. The sculpture will use 3,500 square feet of 304 stainless steel. That's going to be priced at over $1 million. So this guy is an artist, and he's used tungsten air gas welding to produce this fabulous piece of work that's going to sell for a huge amount of money. And here are more sculptures that are done by various artists. And this one here was done by Picasso. And it's in the Plaza in Chicago. And it was made in 1967. And it's on display there. And this is another famous sculpture, The Angel of the North. It's in Gateshead in England, and it was designed by Sir Anthony Gormley. And you can see it's a huge, vast sculpture. And that's the guys over there fabricating and welding the actual head. So you can see how, in relation to the size of the head, these guys are. So it's a vast, fabulous sculpture. So that's my presentation. So thanks for listening. If you have any questions.
Could you go back to the slide before that, please? I just want to ask you about the very interesting. Could you tell me a little bit about those? I mean, the scale of the—are they all ginormous scale, really? Well, I think these—you can see this one here, the first one here is a dragon.
Yeah. And you can see the size of the guy in relation to that. Yeah. So I think the two sculptures are in would be
regular scale.
Yeah, regular scale. And that one is a gate there. That's a huge gate. So you know, but this one here is huge.
Picasso made there. Would he have used the same methods as he would have used in the art industry? Do you think?
Yeah, I think he would have. Yeah, because I think that's stainless steel. So, I mean, they're vast pieces. Now, he would have designed it. He wouldn't have made it.
Okay.
He would have given the design to the architect or to the people who are going to make that, you know. And on that basis, they would have put it all together, tacked it all up, and then welded it, you know. Or they may have actually brought it piece by piece and assembled it actually in the plaza here.
Is it a medium that you're still interested in working in?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, because if you have that knowledge and you have artistic abilities, you know, it's great to have that to walk in, because it means, you know, you've extended, you know, if you can walk in oils, and if you can walk in watercolor, you can walk in charcoal, and next you can walk sculpture, or you can weld. That's brilliant, definitely. Definitely enhances it.
The one on top of that one, the largest one there, is. It looks like it's colouring it. Is that just reflection of the sky, or are those or do some of them include coloured pieces?
Oh, they would be coloured pieces, yeah, definitely, yeah. They can put plastics on it, or they can put, it's amazing what they can do now, you know.
Bill, you know the wing person, the last slide, the...
This one here?
No.
The one before that?
No, the next one, the north person.
Oh, yeah.
On the next slide.
Yeah, this one, yeah.
Do you know what fabric they used for the outside? Was that just metal?
It's just metal. That's all metal. Yeah.
Right.
And it's huge. And I think what they did was it's so big that the hill that it's on is actually underneath the hill. They put a structure in there. They actually bolted it down through the hill. I think it was an old mine, and they used that to copper fasten that huge, gigantic structure, because I mean, it's huge. I mean, even if it was to fall, I know there's no one around, but they have pinned it underneath the ground, you know, so it's fabulous, absolutely.
And do metals and all that, do they tarnish differently? With
yeah, they would. That one there, I think, was made of just mild steel, so I think it's rusting now, you can actually see it, yeah. Because it would have cost a fortune to make that out of stainless steel, you know.
Does stainless steel tarnish?
No, it doesn't. Stainless steel. Yeah, okay. It was discovered, I believe, by accident when they were mixing metals together, and someone threw it out into the yard, and they went out and they realised that this thing wasn't rusting.
Yeah.
So stainless steel was discovered by accident. Yeah.
And it's used by chefs, I suppose, for that purpose, because it can be, you know.
Yeah. Definitely, yeah.
The piece that was going to sell for $1 million.
Yeah.
Do you know anything further about that? Was that to go to a big corporate buyer in Asia or something? Do you know about that? Or?
I'm not too familiar about that. I didn't investigate that, but I imagine that guy is well known now. So he's selling huge pieces.
Or he's private collector.
Yes. Yeah. And he's a well known artist. Mm-hmm.
So if you see on slide number 9. Some of the sculptures on that, they seem to be like the one in the bottom right hand corner, I think you said that was Picasso.
Yeah.
Do they start off with like flat panels of steel? And if so, how do they curve the steel, or heat it, or what way do they get to take its shape and maintain its shape?
That's a good question. What they would do is they might make them in panels, okay? Instead of trying to make a curve out of this huge big piece, they would get them in panels, and they would put them into machines that roll them, that give them a slight curve, and then they get the next one that gives that a slight curve, they attach that to that, and they make the curve with pieces rather than
is that
moving.
All kind of done by eye, do you know, it's
well you'd have a
machine
well that if you can look at that part there, that part is man-made, so you'll see all the man-made, it's either going to be square or circular. They're the man-made shapes, or triangular, or whatever. So they would have used machines, and obviously the craftsman's eye comes into play as well.
Thank you.
Hi, good morning, my name's Sylvia. I'm just going to talk today about ukiyo-e, and it's a genre of Japanese art, and once you translate ukiyo-e, it translates to pictures of the floating world. Ukiyo-e flourished in Japan in the Edo period from 1603 to 1868, and Edo is modern day Tokyo. It was a form of woodblock printing, and the process first began with the artist, and they would design an image and then transfer it to a thin, partly transparent paper. The engraver would then paste the image to wooden block, and usually they use cherry wood, as it would be softwood and easier to carve into. He'd then chisel and cut the image out to create the original, a negative, and the lines would then sorry, the raised lines would then be the coloured image. And then for the final bit, the printer would apply the ink to the surface of the woodblock, and rubbing around the pad over the back of a piece of paper laid over the top of the ink board would create the print. Later, they developed polychrome printing, which allowed them to use different colours, and to do this, they carved out separate blocks for each different colour and kind of just printed it through the process. So why did ukiyo-e flourish in this period? Previous to the Tokugawa family taking over and ruling Japan for 265 years, the land of Japan was mostly just farmers and traders, and the regions were ruled by just the local powerful families, and they'd be in constant battle with each other. But then the peace and stability established stimulated the Japanese economy, and as the economy was doing well, people had more time for leisure, and there was a demand for the finer things in life, as people had more money to spend. Another reason was education. Due to the peace, then parents could focus on their children's education. This led to an increase in literacy. The woodblock printed books featuring popular stories sold by the thousand. These books then enabled the rapid spread of fashion trends and information. Woodblock printing as well, the technology advanced due to refinements in production and increased demand. And the production of prints became faster and cheaper, making them accessible to the common person with a modest income. The subject matter of woodblock printing changed from previous periods, as the patrons of art were now the common people. So there were scenes from the life of the common people, which is Japanese theatre. Scenes from amusement quarters, landscapes, legendary heroes, and nature studies. This one of the first ukiyo-e prints, you can see it's just black and white. So this one, the very first few. And before they had polychrome printing, the more expensive pieces would have been hand-painted. This is just this now with polychrome, and I just really like these pieces because they're just, it's very delicate fine line, and I feel like there's a really nice atmosphere, and the colours are also really like subtle and gentle. These are images or prints of actresses getting ready for a kabuki play. I really like the perspective of the mirror rather than viewing the actress face on. You see her reflected in the mirror, and I just think that's a really intimate kind of scene, and they really capture the kind of fine hair. These are just more kind of theatre actors. And then this one of the most famous ones, Hokusai, the waves. And it was then that the landscapes became popular. And I think he just captures the motion of the waves and the movement of it very well through the print. This is just another one of Hokusai. I just love the colour, the way it's kind of ascending down. I thought it was really nice. So the influence of ukiyo-e on the art world, as you probably know, the Impressionists were very influenced by Japanese prints through composition and also depictions of everyday life. These are just two of Monet's works. And then the influence on my own work, I feel like what I've taken from them is like the movement and work in fine lines, and I was being interested with water, and they seem to have fascination with that as well, and I kind of go for subtle colours, like gentle kind of colours, which I think I do as well. And yeah. Thank you.
Very interesting. I really liked that you connected into your own work and see the influence on a beautifully refined presentation. So yeah, I have to say, very confident, widely delivered, very nice. And just wondering, have you gone in to our neighbour next door to the Chester Beatty and had a look at it?
No, I haven't yet. No.
So we must do that.
Yeah.
And I also have a book on Japanese printmaking that I will give you from a recent exhibition. You may have a lend of that as well. I'm sure some of your colleagues would like to ask.
Yeah.
Would those prints, would they be expensive to buy?
Well, nowadays, yes, because they'd be antiques. But no, back in the Edo period, the common people would have bought them, like tradesmen. They weren't inaccessible to the common people, so they weren't. Yeah.
You know the trees in the watercolor on the last slide.
Then. Oh yeah.
Did you do that?
Yes.
Did you?
Yeah, it's an
exhibition.
Can you tell us a little bit about the medium that you used for that?
It's just watercolor on watercolor paper.
Would you be interested in trying to get into the kind of printmaking?
Yeah, I'd love to try it. I've only ever tried lino printing, but I'd love to definitely give it a go.
I know some of the third level universities, the Arjun, they do
print
faculties.
Yeah.
Very nice, you can see the influence on it. Did you know that Van Gogh's brother Theo was an art dealer and brought in a lot of those things into Europe at that time as well? And the post impressions, they say Van Gogh's work was very related to the carvings of the woodblocks.
The picture you had where you mentioned the gradation of the colour of it, there was a splatter. It's couple above your own work.
Is it this one?
No, it's closer to the end. I was just curious about the red splash in the corner.
This one?
Yeah. So did they, the polychrome prints, is that what they're called?
Yeah.
So is the red like a separate print colour?
Yeah, they would have built it up. Yeah, it's a lot of planning. And yeah, so they would have had like different wood blocks for each colour and just start with the colour for the background and just build it up from there.
It is beautiful.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Just like a watercolor, isn't it?
Yeah.
Warp the lightest color back to the darkest.
Can I ask you about, I know that blue, the colors were kind of, is that ink? Because I know that like some colors were hard to find in
ink.
Thank you. My name's Ciara McGoldrick. I'm in PTAC level six in the Liberties Art College, and it's a great opportunity to present at IMA actually. Never would have thought, you know, I always wanted to be an artist actually, you know, so there you go. You know, you never know what could come around if you put your mind to it. My presentation is on the arts and crafts movement. There were the recognised founders of the movement would be, say, John Ruskin and William Morris. John Ruskin was, an art critic, and William Morris was a designer. He was a poet. He was a socialist, you know, and Augustus Welby Pugin, they were very much influenced by him. He was a Gothic revivalist. So that kind of approach to art and craft, I think, is very interesting, that it brings it to people, you know, that it the process in itself is sustains you as a human, you know, spiritually and emotionally, I suppose. This is, you know, I do not want art for a few any more than education for a few or freedom for a few. You know, there's a very strong ethos, belief in, you know, society and people, I suppose. And that it would benefit society, you know, that you as a craft worker, as an artist, you benefit society. I find that thought very powerful, you know. This here is a couple of samples of, I myself would have known of William Morris, you know, just accidentally. You know, his this would be a wallpaper pattern on the left hand side, and you know, it was introducing nature and color. The design of this, I think, is very well balanced. You know, there's a lot in it, but the colors and the use of color, I think it's I think it brings it together. And like actually Sylvia there was, you know, mentioning that, you know, the papers would have been block printed. This on the right hand side is a embroidered a piece. There's many examples of embroidery and paper, you know, that are, your art is in your home. And yeah, that's that about that one. Here again we have William, two people in the movement, William de Morgan. He would be known for his ceramics, and his wife Mary D. Evelyn, I think her E is Evelyn, and her pictures. So it was trying to, there was a separation of fine art and craft at that time. You know, I think they were valued differently. And Morris and the movement wanted to reunite the arts all together. And you can see here on the left slide, that's, I forget where it is. It's somewhere in England. It's but there's Islamic tiles down on the left-hand side, which he would have been greatly influenced by, you know, the lustres in the ceramic tiles, the pattern, the connection with your culture, your identity. And his own ones are the blue, you know, and that I would very much associate what I've seen so far throughout this year is blue with William de Morgan and his wife. I love this. I think it's really the head tilting. It was on brown paper. You know, I know we've been encouraged in our class to you know use materials around us. I love the tilt of the head and the tone. It's for me, it's lovely. You know, it's a period in history where there was industrialization, you know, so mechanization, you know, the craftsperson was being taken out of the process of making everyday earthenware things to eat your dinner off. So, you know, like all movements, you know, every time it's important for women, but I suppose I am quite interested today as well, you know, women's position in this.
movement. And I suppose this is a bit humorous. It's not that all of it, this slide doesn't represent all the thinking about it, but you know, there was a moral kind of code to the movement, you know, and women had a place in that. And it was believed by some people in the movement that it didn't impact on the woman's role as a wife to paint pottery, to be part of the artistic process. And I read, this was from some paper I read, and I thought it's quite funny that it did not compromise their ability to attract a husband by working as a potter decorator. This now, I only saw this last night, and you know, what I have read to now about the arts and crafts movement is that they didn't have a particular visual style. But I myself, I suppose, would associate a particular style with it. I would associate traditional, you know, patterns, portraits, you know. But I was looking at this woman, Eva Hone, and, you know, stained glass here in Ireland, Harry Clark, you know, he was part of the arts and crafts movement, and well known, beautiful work. But it interested me, you know, it was a new one for me. Eva, I'd heard the name, Evie Hone. You know, this is a piece of her stained glass, and that she also worked as a painter, as a cubist painter. You know, so the idea that, I suppose, art, you can move around it and incorporate lots of different styles. the arts and crafts movement did influence a lot of other styles, you know, including Art Nouveau, Bauhaus, and in my early research work, Lucia Rhee popped up all the time. She embodies, I think, what the arts and crafts movement wanted to promote, you know, that you're at the design stage, you work into making the actual piece, and hopefully it sells, you know, there's also a business aspect to it. I'm a big fan of Lucia Rhee. They're very simple shapes, but the glazing and the texture is very subtle but strong on many of our pieces of work. I mentioned earlier the influence that August Welby Pugin had. You know, he was a Gothic revivalist. And I brought this one up because I was involved in this project a long time ago myself. So this was a Pugin cathedral in Enniscorthy, St. Aidan's. So an architect, a designer, various different craftspeople, you know, sorry, I'll just go back there a minute, because this here is on the arches, that's stencil work. That was the aspect that I was involved in. On the ceiling at the top, that's hand-printed wallpaper. The beams are gilded. So there was a number of craftspeople, artists, I didn't know at the time that we were working together, you know, because you'd be very concentrated on your own part of the job. But I do recall the architect, you know, coming around and talking to you about the historical importance of, you know, this whole work. And that's a detail of the stencil work, very vibrant colours. And I know even in the community, the parishioners were a bit frightened by the strength of the colours that Pugin would use, you know, but they are the colours that Pugin used. And it's all this, you know, combining the your life with your spiritual side, you know, with being well spiritually and, yeah. Just on the left-hand side, it's not a great shot. You can see the stained glass. On the left-hand side, or sorry, in the middle of the picture on the left, that's also the rug is hand tufted, you know, made. And I like this shot of the church. It was a great project to get, I have to say. So I think this to me, really, you know, the tiles, the wooden benches, the, you know, the combination of crafts, the metalwork on the chandeliers there, you know, and that there's harmony with it all. I'm very attracted to that idea of harmonizing. Even mid-assignment, you do forget, you know, that you're there creating. This is William, back to William De Morgan. This is, I'm not actually sure if this is his own bowl or it's from his company. But it's, you know, under the name of William De Morgan. And it's inspired by the Isnik ceramics in Istanbul, and fantastic colors, I think, and texture. You know, that, you know, a very strong, simple shape. You know, he is known for trying to perfect, I suppose we can take glazes for granted, you know, they're just in a bottle, you know, but Eilish was sharing yesterday when I was showing her this slide, that the glazes were, the luster glazes were hugely costly at the time. And they were in bags. I'm not quite sure, I should have listened, but there, it was like a powder and a gel or something, you know, mixed together to create a luster, which I loved. And in the pottery, my own ceramic work, I accidentally mixed two glazes together that achieved a luster. The colour of it now, yeah. Here we have, I forget what I was going to say about this one there, but here we have different, on the left-hand side is a Japanese ceramic, and on the right it's the Isnik styles. Part of the arts and crafts movement encouraged you to express your culture and your identity. In Japan, I loved this one on the, actually I love them all two images, but you know, the shades of brown, you know, the richness of that glaze on that dish, and the hand-painted slip design over it, and you use that, you know, that these things you use, you know, you sit on a chair that's been embroidered by a craftsperson, you know, use a mug that an artisan has created. You know, art isn't precious in for people, that is. This is, you know, my own work, which I was inspired by an Isnik tile. So I designed the handle to reflect a pattern from that tile. And I also, I purposely, I remember at the time, you know, you can get very engaged in your work when you're doing it. And I was thinking, should I show I know how to make a proper bowl here, or what's of value here to me that I want it to look handmade, or I'll push to try and create a perfect bowl. And at that stage of when I was making the bowl, I just decided I wanted it to look handmade, you know. So I definitely, I think if you see it, you could tell it's handmade. And this was the luster kind of sheen I was talking about. You know, by playing around in the with the glazes, I had put a black glaze and a blue together and fired it. I didn't expect it to come out green, but I loved it. You know, so I had done a sample tile and here it's grand. I think I thought to myself, this, as things are going through your head when you're doing your work, I was saying, this does represent being Irish to me. You know, it represents the landscape. It represents the bogs, you know, on the inside. I don't have a shot. It's black. But I connected with parts, or many parts, of the stages of work that I was doing. But yeah, I think that is, they are the just a few of the references that I looked up.
Going back to the church in mm-hmm. Wexford, mm-hmm. And you were working on the
stencil work.
Stencil. Mm-hmm. So were you guys restoring what was there?
No. The stencil work had been painted over. So the cost of removing the paint that was there was prohibitive. So what was decided, my understanding, what was decided is that it would be reinstated. There was a parishioner had a photo of the church. It was hard to locate a photo, I believe. So I forget the chap's, an art historian, and this designer draftsperson drew up the designs from the poster, and they would have connected, you know, Pugin would have had similar designs. So that's how those designs came about, from a photo. And then we scaled them up and cut them and applied them. It was a massive job.
How long did it take you to do it?
There was a few of us.
Yeah. In the project.
On the stencil work, myself and my business partner, and about 6 months. Mm-hmm. You know, because it's all
around. The church, it actually looks magnificent. It has a beautiful photograph, the one that you took that from where you could see the transept of the nave and a whole lot. Yeah.
This one?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great, Sean. That's off the web, and then I want to do. Actually, I think that's the architect that took that, Sheridan.
Yeah, and even the vaulting. Yeah, you know, it's a beautiful church. Well worth going down to, mm-hmm. I'd say. Mm-hmm.
Thanks, Martin. Yeah.
Around the ball that you made, do you have anything to take it to put together?
Do you know what I've discovered? Each, it's the drying process. So making the first form probably took me, to do it right, like 2 hours, you know, by the time you roll it, maybe even a little longer. And the handles and the design, you know, once you start, you know what you're doing, the whole piece has come together very quickly. But drying time and everything, I'd say a week.
What's a Gothic revivalist?
I was hoping you wouldn't ask. Here's the Gothic revivalist. It's, now Maria, you can help me out if you, it's like they wanted to, it was a style of architect.
Yeah, it's a bit like, you know, say pseudo-Georgian or mock-Georgian, sort of like borrowed from.
Yeah, it's been revived.
Yeah. Sorry, Bill.
You mentioned it twice.
Yeah.
I just stuck in my head.
Yeah, and I should have a clearer.
No,
because you see, you know, it's the Gothic and the medieval and Romanesque would have been around the much earlier period, and then this was in the much later. So they say, it's a bit like Renaissance.
Yes.
The revival of the ancient antiquity of Greece and Rome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a very good question.
Yeah, thanks. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Kira. I'm in Liberties College doing art in level 6. And I chose surrealism to do in my presentation because I'm really interested in it. I always find that if you do something you're really interested in, it makes it easier for yourself and it's fun to do then. And so I start off with Dali because I feel like he is well known in surrealism, and I did see that the one there, the two heads in Imma when I came to see the What We Call Love exhibition, and it was amazing to see that the original in the gallery, like it was just amazing. And then the fourth one I have there, I always really liked this and I always represented it as the melting clocks, and I know that's not what it's actually called, but when I see that, it's like he has like beautiful scenery in it, so it's like he's thinking, he's away in a land and it's really beautiful, but it's like the time is dragging by, and I feel like the clocks got tired, because it's like that's how, like it feels like just a really long day, but it's still a really nice piece to like look at, and it's really pleasant to see. The colours are really nice, and I love the tones in it because it's really evening. I love that time of day as well. So, and then I started off, my inspiration in surrealism started off with F.E. McWilliam when I went to Belfast to see his studio. I really love the Leg series because he really captures women's figures, and it's not like he's not really about size, like it's not all models like skinny, it's he captures what women actually look like. We're not all models, like, you know. And then the first one is, I think it's the time of the Troubles in Belfast, and it's a woman being blown away in a bomb, and I think it's really powerful because we always remember the men in the Troubles and men in wars, and it is really important to remember that the women were affected too, like women, although the men did support for families and stuff, the women were holding their families together and they were trying to protect their children, and I think it is really powerful. And then so, well, as I was inspired by F.E. McWilliam, I did want to go on and kind of recreate it myself, so I went on in ceramics, I see I have it in my notebook, and I tried to recreate, I put it in a bowl type thing to put my own like spin on it, and it has a bit of a frill around it, so anyone could take that, and it could look like a skirt to someone, it could look like anything. But unfortunately that ball broke on me, so I got the chance to like experiment with it, so it was fun as well. And as you say, as the reason why I do like surrealism as well is because what is perfect in surrealism? Like, you can't say that is wrong because it's your interpretation of something as well. So I glued it back together with hot glue and experimented with the glaze and stuff. So then when I did that, it was after I thought it could be as I was saying, the women kind of were holding the families together and stuff. That could be it. The glue holding the legs together represent that everyone was trying to hold their families together in the time of the Troubles. And like, it was really hard for everyone. Okay, so I then remade the bowl because it was something that I really liked, and I was devastated when it broke. But these things happen in art, and you just have to work with them. And the way I actually really like that now, you work with it and you make something else of it. So then I remade the bowl and it turned out like well again. I was like happy with how it turned out again, and that's my interpretation of F.E. McWilliam's Legs series. That one. So then I actually only recently came across this artist, and I was amazed when I seen it because I had been doing work in ceramics, and then I was inspired by this because it's really, it's just mad. Like, you wouldn't think of doing stuff like this. So I absolutely love this artist and how I just feel like she doesn't, or he or she, I don't know, but doesn't care what people are gonna say about it. Like, that's a plate that people eat off, but there's a mountain hands coming out of it. So it's just really, some people might be like, wow, like, imagine finding that at the end of your cornflakes, but like, I love it. Like, I just think it's amazing. And they're really, like, they are really well, like, for displays. I think it catch a lot of people's eyes. So then I then again wanted to interpretate my own on this type of work. Now, I did different ones. I did, you can see an ear in a bowl. So I was kind of going with the, I absolutely love body parts, and I always try to work with it in art. And I suppose the reason behind the ear is that you become, because I'm in college and it's my second year doing in Liberties, you become wiser as you go on, and that includes having to listen and being listened to as well, and being like, don't be afraid of the criticism as well. I think that's really important in art. So I suppose that was the idea for the ear, and it's really simple, I think. So I really like that. And then I have a finger in a bowl, and I have my fingerprints around it. And that's more because in art, we do want to be recognized for our work, but we don't really say it. We're not really, artists aren't really up forward a lot of the time. And we do want to be recognized for our work. So I suppose the identity in the fingerprint is trying to show that. And then the, like, I love like blood and stuff, it's great. So the reason behind that is the hard work that we all do, like everyone does. And it's shown that you do have to get your hands dirty in art, and it's okay because it does pay off in the end. So then we have surrealism is also known as the Dada movement, because the paintings are described as ridiculous. But I do completely disagree, because I think these paintings bring you into a different world that you won't imagine yourself. You see, as I've seen some of the paintings in the what we call Love Exhibition in Emma, I've seen Picasso, I've seen Salvador Dali, and I absolutely loved them all, and I was amazed that they were the originals. Like, I was just like, what? Like, there are original paintings. Like, I was so amazed. And but when you look at these, anyone can take anything from surrealism. You can look at something and I could see something completely different to what you could see. But that's what I love about it, because like there is endless possibilities in it. So I could see a scenery as the Dali, the forest painting, as I said, I feel like time was dragging by and it was just endless, type dreary, but you could see something completely different, you could take something completely different. The artist itself probably didn't mean that to come across, but for me, that's the way I took it. And sometimes I feel like, because surrealism is the artist's unconscious mind, but I feel that sometimes could be the artist's reality, like his escape, if it is well, because in college you are working and I'm constantly thinking about work all the time and college work. So surrealism, like, it's fun. That's why I like doing it. I like being interested in something I'm doing. So when I'm doing that, it kind of takes you from your work for a minute. You're in a different world, you're taking what you want from this art, and I just love that about it, that it does take you from your reality for a minute. And then we have Duchamp's fountain piece, which I do think looks like the urinal. I think that's what it is. But it does also have a woman figure, I think, is seated, and it is like so simple, but it was really popular, and it's really big and probably sold for millions. And at the side he has a signature, but it's not his signature. So that's what I mean by putting your mark on things. Maybe people don't want their name across sometimes, but that is shown, like that's the original thing. And then I thought that was very good, the humour in the Duchamp was here in the toilet. I love the humour in it. No, I think that's it, yeah. So, hi.
That was so interesting and another excellent presentation.
Thank you. Any questions?
Yeah, I like the way you you know, made the connection that you have been spurred to do the surrealism and Dada by, you know, to a large extent having come to the exhibition here.
Mm-hmm.
It's really nice.
Yeah.
And it's lovely to see, if I just might make this comment, to see a young and upcoming artist like yourself to embrace that.
Yeah.
You know, and to, I like the fact that you disagreed with the art critics at the time who called the surrealism ridiculous. Mm-hmm. It would have been called that at the time.
Yeah.
I saw your bowl with the finger.
Yeah.
I love your glaze. And you have, I meant to ask you before, you had a drip coming down on it in a kind of goldy syrupy.
Mm.
Was that the
that,
blood?
Yeah, that was the blood. It was red. See, that's the thing about like the glaze and ceramics. It's all about testing out. You don't really know how it's going to turn out. No, I was really happy with it, how it turned out, but I didn't have a picture of it yet because it only recently came out of Killam. But yeah, it was intentional in everything.
Yeah.
So yeah.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
I thought it was very interesting, the leg series.
Yeah, I loved that.
And it was nice that you put it into your ceramics
as well. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks. Hi. Sorry, can I ask it? Because I didn't know your man. It's a man, is it Williams?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What did he work with?
He was more of a sculptor. He did like, I think he did like more metals and stuff like that. Now he did, I don't think he actually did ceramics, he probably did. But he is from Belfast, and I just found him really interesting because he did a lot of the, he was actually in the Troubles, and I loved that because he expressed that in his art, and you kind of, when you see his art, you kind of feel like you're with the artist.
Yeah.
So I loved that about art as well, and I loved that whole like series. I think it's great. Right. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Christina Bukhtinov. I go to Liberties College for 2 years now. I did level 5 last year and I'm doing level 6 this year. I'm really enjoying the course so much more this year than I was last year. I feel like I've really progressed in my work, and I love my classmates, you know. Yeah, my presentation is on still life and more so the different styles that you can use. It doesn't always have to be oil paints. It can be pop art and it can be abstract. I'm going to show you some of the examples that I like myself. I picked 5 overall. By the end of this presentation, you will know and explore 5 different styles of painting on still lifes. It's really interesting and I think you'll enjoy it. What is still life? It's a painting or a drawing on arrangement of objects. So usually they're flowers or fruit, and then to contrast with other objects, it'd be like vases, glasses, bowls as well. The first one there with the fruit is by Peter D, and he's Dublin based, but he's from Kerry, so he's Irish. And he mainly works in oils, and he's really like vibrant in his color, but in this particular photo, it's kind of dim, but it shows light and texture with the different sorts of fruits. And the other one is by Annie O'Brien, which is a still life as well, but they're, as you can see, they're kind of different. She's more contemporary expressionist, leans towards abstract, but it's not too abstract, I don't think. And different types of still life is classicism. It's typically restrained. It's not
out there. It's really like how you see it, you know. The first one is oil painting in realism, so it's really realistic, just like a photograph by David Gray. And the other one, it's more like, obviously it's not still life, I think it's this person's interpretation of a still life with the roots and the vines and the lemons. It's actually part of a series, and that each series is a season, and this is the winter one that I thought was very good. And the next one's abstract still lives. They're both abstract, but they're so different. The first one's really kind of messy, and the next one is a lot neater. And first one's by Jan Ripley Ham, and the second one's by Jeff Burns. The first one's acrylic life fast inks on watercolor paper, and the second one is
still life oranges.
I really like them. I like the first one better, I think. And the next one is pop art. And pop art is based on modern culture of the mass media, especially as a critical or ironic comment on traditional fine art values. It's very cartoony, but I think it's really pleasing to the eye. I find so myself. The first one is by famous pop artist Roy Lichtenstein. He's really good. He doesn't just do still lifes, he does a lot of other iconic kind of works. And the second one is a Brazilian paper. He was in the New York Times, and they described his work as very warm and like optimism and love and stuff like that. It's good. It's kind of a fusion of cubism and pop art, which is interesting that you can combine the two. And the second one is cubism. And that's, if you don't know what that is, it's different perspects all in the one image, which is really interesting. I haven't actually worked like that myself, but it's very interesting. It'd be nice to keep up. The first one is by Roy Lichtenstein again. So he doesn't just do pop art, he does cubism as well, which is a good. And the second one is, I don't know if you can notice, but they're grapes and pears on a table in a bowl. And it's mad because the whole idea of space is rearranged, and I just think that's so interesting. And then the next one I really like, and that's mixed media. And it's like still life with different media all kind of thrown in, and the different types. Like the second one is collage, but the first one's more like different materials added in. The second one there with the green jug is by Caroline Street. And this is one I did myself, and it's a still life. I did it this year. And I, as you can see, I put in so much different materials. I was kind of experimenting with it, but I was really happy. What it originally was a big sheet with cups and mugs kind of hanging from it, and boxes and teapots and stuff like that. And I used newspaper, paper mache, coffee stick stirrers. I used acrylic paint, I used ink, I used pieces of jigsaw, I used a bit of wallpaper, some rope string as well. And these are some still lifes by famous artists, if you could probably guess which the first one is. That's by Vincent van Gogh, and the second one's by Picasso, and they're very famous, so you've definitely seen these works before. Just kind of an example of what is there. Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Very good, Christina, and such a big wide range of still life going right. I was looking at the one by Archimboldo, and you could see that it's a face. Did you see that?
Yeah, I didn't notice that at first.
You can see it from back here, you see.
Yeah.
So they were playing.
Yeah.
A little bit surreal as well,
right? Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And actually that last one by Picasso, the last one, it's beautifully
subtle, isn't it?
Yeah. Look at the lovely softness.
Any questions? Yeah?
So, who is your favourite still life artist, and did it inspire you when you did your still life?
From doing this presentation, I properly researched about like pop art, still life, and I really like that. I'd like to try it myself, but I haven't actually. But with the mixed media, I mean I love the pair, and I really want to start trying to use like a manuscript in a collage, because I think that just looks lovely. And I did music for like 5 years in secondary school, so I have loads of them, and I'm not doing anything with them, so that'd be really good. But I don't know, I don't particularly have a favorite still life artist, but
I liked the personal piece that you did. That was very good. You're onto something with that, you know. There's some really nice aspects of it, you know. So that piece, I think it's very interesting, and I think you could develop on that.
Yeah, definitely.
By continuing to study the masters of that.
Yeah.
You know? Actually, sorry, Justine, to say, when Kira was doing her on Evie Hull, there was an exhibition here some years ago. I can't remember how many we were at it. And it was here in Emma, and Evie Hull and Mary Swansea and Hull. Yeah. Oh my
gosh.
Yeah.
Can I
hear
something?
Yeah.
I haven't done much of the collage kind of stuff,
right.
But I know there was a huge amount of work in that. Just on a technical point, were certain glues easier to use than others, or adhesives?
I used for all of it, pretty much I used PVA.
PVA.
Yeah, because it's very liquidy, but I did that on a cardboard, so it didn't go true. But it just, I thought it was a lot better to hold everything together rather than print stick, you know? Especially for the newspaper, I put the glue down, then I ripped the newspaper, stuck that down as well, and then I put glue over it.
Oh,
and I just thought it looked nicer, you know?
Is that acrylic paint or oil pastels? In the circular bluey white pieces.
This.
No.
This.
Yeah.
That's acrylics.
Okay, and then little orange little.
This.
Things, yeah.
Acrylic, and this is chalk, and that's acrylic. That's charcoal. That's pencil. That's acrylics again.
And you have a good handling of media over media, so you know. It's good.
And the paler green. What is the paler
this?
Green? No, off.
Oh, this.
Yeah.
That's it was part of some wallpaper that Ailish just had.
Yeah,
and
lovely.
I put it, and then there was creases in the sheet, and I put the brown paper mache, like kind of, and then now they just look like tree branches, which is, it's nice, I think.
Did you, the object in the picture, did you draw them?
Oh yeah, I repeated. It. So there was actually, I forgot to mention that, there was two cups here, and then I repeated it twice, and then there was only two here, and I repeated that, and then I repeated this one down here, and there was only one, like, jug thing here, and I repeated that four times, and then this one was repeated as well. Yeah.
That's great, because you're tracking composition.
Yeah.
You're onto something, Christine.
Thank you.
Because there's a lot more when we've asked you, there's a lot more that you put a lot of intent into that, you know, into the structures.
Yeah.
The two on the pink box, the two jokes?
Them, yeah.
And is that pencil or what is it?
That's ink, blue ink. But I think I first drew it with pen.
Right.
And then ink over it as well, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. So thank you for listening.
Okay, hello, my name is Derek Lawler. I'm going to do a presentation. My featured artist was a young painter from the 1980s called Basquiat. As you can see, he was born in the mid-70s. He had a pretty strict family and was did dabble a bit with art in school, but didn't really pursue it. When he was about 8 years old, he was involved in a car accident, and while he was recuperating, his mother gave him a book called Grey's Anatomy to pass the time while he was healing from his injury. And he basically practiced drawing with the book. His style when he was growing up was very kind of, the best way to describe it is kind of outsider, like no training. He's kind of drawing on, in school he did like notebooks for band practice and this, he'd do banners and stuff for people. I was researching, doing my own work. I liked him before I came to school, but only when I came to school that I did more research on his influences. And the main, for my personal project in Combined Materials, I found out that his main influence basically was Buffett, John the Buffett. I'm not sure if I'm saying the name right. And outside of art. And John the Buffett was, I think, the might be the early 50s artist. And he wasn't happy with like his own art and the way he was drawing. And he tried to take like the that art looks good, or that drawing has to look a certain way. He wanted to communicate things straightforward in a very instant way, like anger or how he's feeling. And he took influence himself from art done by patients in mental hospitals. There was a book made in the 50s called The Art of the, I think it's something like the art, psychiatric art. And this guy, G. Roberts, was in a mental asylum. And he was like a very, he's well known, not well known now, but he is known as like the standout artist of outsider art. When it wasn't as well known, like when it was starting. He did art all the way while he was in hospital. I think he had really bad mental problems. But when I did my research, I found out that through my research that he used, when you're learning, you kind of stick to someone else to kind of get confidence in what you're doing, and that what you're doing is okay, the confidence to get, or that it's okay to do something. And he basically, the top picture, he liked the Buffett because the figures are very childlike, or very simply drawn, and it's not pretentious, and it's not worried about trying to give a straight story, or like impress anyone, or it's breaking everything, kind of deconstruction. I learned deconstruction this year, I didn't know it before. Sorry. And it's he basically, the first picture he liked, well, I think when he there's influence anyway, carry on, I have to go down and show you some of the guy's own work. Anyway, the one thing I did notice when I do my own research was that this picture, and a lot of art in psychiatric hospitals is that you write down how you feel to overcome an illness, and there's no automatic drawing. you don't think about impressing anyone, you just, how you're not ashamed to draw whatever way you want. And I found the link between that picture and a lot of early cave art, especially in Algeria. They're very similar compositions of people working and kind of almost stick figures. I wanted to show something about this picture that I think, well, from what I get from this picture, is that the brain and the wires is like electricity, kind of information, and how people are connected to each other. It's almost like a factory looking thing. He took from this picture the idea of a head with a brain, basically, and wires coming out of it to communicate. So I think he used both of these artists as one for like a composition and how to start proper painting once you got going. Now I'll show you, that's a painting from a nomad tribe called the Berbers in Algeria, and it's very similar to a lot of stuff you'd see children do, or if you kind of outsider art as well, but that's like centuries ago, and uncanny how similar they are. I think that the artist himself saw that and linked the two together, and but he never specifically said it, so I'm kind of making my own leap, but I found very exciting where to go to look for research, or where I'm fascinated with how these artists cover up their influences. They say they don't, but like when you dig in, you kind of find more stuff than you thought you would. John de Buffet, his influence was art done by people who are not traditionally trained in art, as I said, living in hospitals. Basquiat's mother was institutionalized when he was 13, and he went to visit her like religiously. His mother used to bring him to museums, and I think he was a junior member of the National Museum in New York when he was like 8 years old. So his mother kind of put in him an appreciation for art. And I think when he went to visit, I don't really know, but I think when he went to visit in hospital, he got the idea for outsider art, I think. Don't quote me on it. Sorry, the slideshow. Okay, getting back to the guy I was starting to talk about, Basquiat. He was started doing phrases in notebooks, like poetry. He was very into early hip hop and kind of jazz music, and he was kind of street poetry, using street language and slang. And there's a term, he went around with his friend when he became home, his parents kicked him out when he was 17, I think, and he vowed never to go back. But he started selling, basically he started making paragraphs of stories. And the idea was that you repeat words, chop up sentences, and rearrange it. And it's called the cut-up technique. And it basically means that if you take paragraphs, cut it into four, and rearrange them, the thinking was that you could tell the future from what came out. He started tagging neighborhoods with his friend, and they came up with a hyphen for their name, like what they went as. And they went as Samo, and Samo means same old. Basically, what they said was that they were tired of seeing white galleries with white people drinking white wine, and they wanted to go against that idea that it was like a white. That's my thing. He got very well known around New York. No one knew what he looked like. What everyone was talking about, saying, "Oh, who is this guy?" He got the idea from
the colour technique by William Burroughs. Now, William Burroughs is a very well-known author from, I think, the early, late 60s. And he did a book called Naked Lunch, which is kind of like Hunter S. Thompson, very drug influenced, very candid about his life. He was gay himself, but he was very, he used the cut-up technique in his book all the way through the book, and it like it brings it into this. The story might start in a coffee shop, but he'd repeat sections of the story, and you'd end up somewhere totally different in like fantasy land. Another side note, Kurt Cobain, favorite author as well, is William Burroughs, and he used the same technique. I think Bowie did as well when he's coming up with his songs. So the guy is, he picked a very good source in his work. This is the of Basquiat's notebook during that time when he was coming up with these poems, and you can see in it that darkness is repeated twice, the water, he's beginning to break up words and rearrange them. I think this is done basically so that he was a very shy person, and the whole idea of deconstruction is, for me, what I get from it is that it's broken down so much that you can't tell too much about the personal story of the person themselves. I think they wanted to keep part of themselves back. When he was homeless in his late teen years, he went to New York and started hanging around with a lot of young creative people. This is when Andy Warhol was like the king of New York, basically, and he hung around with people like, I don't know if you know, Kenny Scharf is another one. Keith Haring was like very close. They both held their first exhibition together, the two of them. And interesting, they're both street artists as well. Basically, he was living on the street and kind of selling cards to try and get by, saying that he's paying €10 go for a card in Madison Square Garden. A friend of his that was a curator suggested that he get some paint and start painting, and this is one of the earliest ones. It's going along with the kind of car crash. As you can see, it's very childlike, simple drawn, but you can grasp something from it. You can tell, obviously, it's a car. You can't exactly tell what exactly he's talking about. And I like it because his work, because it's edited. It's like he'd wipe away pieces if he doesn't like what's there. One thing I did find out is that he did a heck of a lot of drawing before he started doing a painting. It wasn't just, okay, I'm going to paint now and that's it. I think that aspect. Stays at a friend's house and brings home the object. He had a girlfriend that he met and kind of convinced her to let him stay with her for free, basically. And he started bringing home tires and doors and all manner of stuff and painting it. I think this is a fridge from the girl's house. It's basically practicing on anything you can find. And it's very like the mental health art with the simple figures, and you can kind of make out the top of the head that he's trying to information and objects coming from the head, like coming from the brain. His work is described now as neo-expressionism. It's a continuation of the abstract expressionists. The abstract expressionists are Jackson Pollock. It's mainly categorized as breaking down objects and describing the world in a crude way. In a crude way, I mean that the drawings are crudely done, or nothing is idealized. Also, his work uses words as colour. I like that. It's as I said, that words go out onto the page as if you'd flow paint out onto a page. And it's not just done to
fit in the painting. It's done as a to direct it basically around the painting. The main component that was work on it was a big head or figure, sometimes a famous figure, pop stars or musicians. Yeah, the figure in the middle. As you can see as well, this is when he started painting for real. I like them because the line is so crudely done. I think he used a lot of oil bars in his work to fill in sections. I mainly like them because it's brave just to be that ugly, to paint ugly and not really care. There's a story that when he was starting to get known, that he saw Andy Warhol in a coffee shop and went in and tried to sell him some paints or some postcards. And he said to him, do you want to buy some crummy art or some bad art? And Andy Warhol said, they're not very good, I'll give you $10 for them. You haven't really worked a lot on them. But he was still a full of confidence. And Andy Warhol's agent was in at the coffee shop as well, and almost had the rest of the cards out of Andy Warhol's hands. He wanted them for himself. As I said, street slang. A key figure of his work that I like is the honesty of that he describes where he is in a very straightforward way. It's said that he brings the colour of the street into his work. And he stands up for his heritage by showing the mistreatment of black people, the slave trade, and generally the unfairness of society sometimes. A word often best described is, deconstruction, communications program. This is a picture of the background to the picture is that a graffiti artist was painting under a subway in New York that looked very similar to him, and he said he would probably have been him because he has gone out at night and spray painted, and the guy ended up in a coma because basically policeman bed him up. And as you can see, you can kind of get the gist of the image without any words or, because there's no clear explanation needed, it's very simple. It's in plain terms, he didn't want the viewer, he painted what, as well as taking stuff home from the streets. He painted abandoned buildings on doors. It's even said that he had a very bad drug habit near the end of his career, and that drug dealers would take his work. You know, it was said before that you could date Basquiat's painting by the footprints that were on it. So he didn't really, he wasn't too, hands off with his work. I like that because it's kind of, I don't like the idea that work is like you treat a baby or something, that it's not precious. But I think if you start the process of art and that I'm precious and this is precious and my ideas are precious, that I don't think you're going to get anywhere after that. And in order to get over yourself, to be honest, influences in my work of Basquiat, I like the child drawings that Basquiat does. What I learned through the course that we're on now is the idea of recording the work. Because what I used to do before is I'd draw and not be happy with it, and then put too much lines over it. And one of the key components of the outsider art is that there's no, you don't stop yourself from doing bad stuff or drawing in a bad way or
censoring yourself, basically. And I think as an artist, one of the hardest things to do to get in the way of yourself when you're trying to make work. The other thing I learned from this course is decalage, which is where you write on paper and add it to the canvas as you're going, rather than drawing on the canvas and painting over, which doesn't really work. And I don't think I learned anything when I used to do that. So, I also learned just recently that it's important to like loosen up the drawing when you're doing it. Not be protective about the drawing. It's more like, you're not trying to define what the thing is when you first start doing it. And a drawing is not meant to be perfect on and then you stop. I learn more by, I actually enjoy rubbing out stuff more this year. I actually realized that rub out sections, add in sections, I think it helps my work. This is my personal project for ceramic, one of the plans for it. As you can see, there's a figure at the top left and a figure in the middle. This is kind of copying basket early stuff where the figure, you know, I'm not too concerned what the figures look like. And it's also similar in that stuff is coming from almost out the brain of the figures that are in it. This is like a preparatory for my personal project. It's not really meant to be seen by other people because it would be embarrassing. But one thing I did get out of said was that I can do one, set it aside and do one other, which is I am grateful for Elis for teaching me how to do. I think that the main thing is the automatic drawing. What I did learn in this class is that continuous drawing, where the pencil doesn't leave the page, helped me a lot in defining figures in a soft way, which greatly helped me, I think, improve what the objects look like when I'm drawing them. Because before that, I would have just rubbed stuff out and wouldn't have to be the line. This is my work below from my personal project. I'll show you the one first. This is the plan for my personal project, which I'm doing now, which is decalage again, taking objects that as a source material, pinning them down onto the page, but not going over them. Like, my idea is that the figure on the right hand side is going to be the main figure in the piece. I grew up in Ballymun, so this is kind of like me being honest about Ballymun. I think a lot of the stuff in the middle is kind of working out how the drawing is going to go. This is kind of like the last one. I did a few before and it's kind of working up the figures in the middle. So the figure there is like a mock-up of the child on the right side. What I decided to do for my project is bring in doors and cupboards into the work. I like the idea of attempting stuff that looks crazy from the outside, but trying it anyway. As you can see, a lot of the lines are very simple. Like, I didn't have to do much rubbing out because of the continuous drawing that I learned in the class, which really helped. This will be three sections. The idea is that I put it down and can add color or take away or add more paper on top as I go along, which really helps. Also, the present day, when I was doing my presentation for a personal project, I showed this image, which is of Jonathan Mies. Jonathan Mies is, I think, 40 years old, German artist working today. And I can see he's also expressionist, but I think it goes further out there than Basquiat ever did. And I think I have more appreciation for art done today
because of the research that I do in the school. It was from this idea that I had this stupid idea of a triptych that you do three figures. I think this is even more ambitious expression than Pascal's work, because the figures are like less recognizable than that work. And I like this work. I think it's the paint work is kind of similar at the moment. Thank you for listening. I've been bored.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So fascinating, really, really excellent. Would you mind just, I know it was a long presentation, would you go back a good few slides? I'll tell you when to keep going. There's one, it's the one before this one. Okay. If you look at that, that is incredibly accomplished, that piece, isn't it? Do you see the balance in the composition, in the tone, the subtlety, like that? I wonder about that painting, I wonder where is it now? I'm not putting you on the spot, but would anybody else agree with that? Look at the, I think that's very carefully done, in actual fact.
Yeah.
What do you think, Derek?
I think, what I didn't realise when I came into this course, because I didn't do, Ailish kind of taught me to gave me advice basically to, I was fond of the documentaries about artists, but I wasn't too fond of like how they did it. I thought it was a mystery how they did it. But what I think now is that it is kind of more considered than I thought it was. When I first thought, I thought he just splashes bits here and covers in with bits of red. The colors, I like this, you see the kind of, I call it kind of when, you know, when you paint a window, when you cover windows, I like the streaks going out that almost look wet or kind of milky colours. I like them. The harmony in the colour, I like, I don't really know too much about.
I think he's got depth and perspective in that. And then the two central in the foreground, and then the figure, the big central figures. I just think it's incredibly considered, actually. You know, I'm very curious to know. Yeah, that's a task for you to find out. Where is that? Who has it? We want to know, don't we?
Yeah.
I think that was a really, really excellent presentation, Derek.
Okay.
You know the one with the boy that you drew? The boy that you drew?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it said like RIP on the top,
yeah.
But at the bottom it looked like it had a gun.
I
was just wondering, what is the story behind that? Or if it's private, like you don't have to tell me.
The main thing people know about him for is like needles. And I think I've done needle syringes. Drugs in previous work, and I was kind of going, I like the idea of when you're younger and you had stickers on your wardrobe, and if you were bored you'd kind of think about this kind of like they're talking to each other or communicating with each other. I couldn't figure out whether it was kind of, I'm still censoring myself about do I want to do. You kind of want to go your own way, but you don't want, it's like, I guess it's a play on like what people think young people do in Ballymun. I put it there because I kind of thought attitude. I think people in these areas have not very, people might say not a very good attitude, but a very tough attitude from a young age. And I like the idea of the gunslingers, I don't know. And like, I know cowboys, like, a lot of cowboys were not like very young, and I just, from the way he was standing, I just like the idea of a weapon.
And is RIP like kind of like goodbye to your childhood?
No, RIP is kind of like, I wanted to show the honesty that like the main victims in poor neighborhoods are young people.
Right.
And I didn't want it to be just a statistic, like, I was playing around with the idea of the way when people are announcing dates, they kind of whittle it down to like numbers, 1 to 20% of the population. I don't know, 6% of people died in hospitals. I didn't want to do that, so I was kind of wrestling with the idea, do I just show a real victim of drugs in Valley One, or maybe the gun is kind of like a way of fighting back. It's edited stage, still not finished. The figure idea was that I was going to have him in the coffin, or like, you know, like a crime scene. And I like the idea of, maybe I'm trying to explain too much in the drawing to other people. Like, I feel like I have to add in guns and stuff so other people would get it. So that's the struggle with the drawing. I think the gun is just adding stuff in. The main thing I'm trying to get was that you see the kid, you see the kid. It's not like, is that a man, is that a...
Very interesting though. Well done.
Thanks.
Eric, also, I have a question. Do you feel this art style expressed who you are as an artist or self more so than...
I think it's meant to represent like not something that I'm not. It is a direct representation, because I did grow up in flats like that, and I wasn't that age, I was kind of younger. I think it's like, it's trying to, a lot of the stuff is trying to stand up for people that like, we all have stuff in our past that we couldn't stand up for, that when you grow up, you kind of stand up for other people when they're in that position, so it's kind of, yeah.
I think the meaning is as well, though, the unpretentious style, isn't it? Did you say at the beginning of your presentation that you like this sort of unstylized, very fluid, opposite of false, sort of non-pretentious art?
No, it's not. It's like when I saw the figure of the kid, I kind of thought like Caravaggio, you know, like the streetwise kids. Kind of thing. I don't like the idea. I normally wouldn't show this stuff, and I try and rub it out, because I don't think it's the stuff I'm trying to. I know I have to do it to edit it to get it to where it needs to be, but I don't like the idea of people seeing everything. And I think you can use art as a way of. I like people like Rothko and Whistler that were very like, anytime you asked them what their art was about, it was like, get out of here. What you want. And
we have sensed that on Tuesdays, I must say. Well done.
Thank you.
Well done.
Hi, I'm Frances, and this is my presentation on Yayoi Kazuma. I used her last year as a reference artist for my pattern project in Metalcraft. As you can see, lots and lots of polka dots. She's a Japanese artist and writer. She started from a very young age, but she didn't like the art style in Japan at the time, the very like stylistic Nihonga thing they did back then. So she moved up to America during the 1960s and came involved with lots of pop art. She influenced many people like Andy Warhol. She kind of faded from the art scene after she moved back to America, not America, Japan, because of her mental health problems. She suffered an abusive past from her mother, and because of that she suffered various hallucinations. She used the polka dots in her art, like, because sometimes when she had her hallucinations, dots would appear around the room, they wouldn't disappear. She'd become very dizzy. I kind of discovered that there. But when she was in the mental hospital, she continued to work. She started writing poems and her own autobiography. She still, she decided to live in the mental hospital permanently, and still is art today. pumpkins have always been really important to her since her family were farmers. She thought they were all very, very, like a very strong vegetable and uses them as a personal identification. And again, more polka dots since they're a running theme in her work. She was very obsessed with repetition. And her own quote there, she describes herself as an obsessional artist. People may call her otherwise, but she lets her work speak for itself. She says that the polka dot has the form of the sun, which is a symbol of energy of the whole world and her lively life, but also a form of the moon, which is so calm, round, soft, colourful, senseless, and unknowing. Polka dots become movement. Polka dots are a way to infinity.
So she's very interesting. So she's considered the most important, most prominent artist in Japan.
Yeah.
And she stays by choice, or is she kept?
She signed herself in and decided to keep on living in the mental institution.
Okay. Do you see her quote?
Yeah.
So she's saying that she's compelled to make these pieces, and that everybody can classify her whatever way they want.
Yeah, it's more like her hallucinations. Like the one of her works, she was saying she was staring at a flower and then polka dots started appearing on the flower, and then when she looked away from the flower, they were all over the room.
And has she affected or influenced your own work, do you think?
Only really last year when I was doing the pattern project.
Okay, and and she's very well received in the art world.
She kind of vanished from it after she left America. People say that like she kind of came overshadowed by the male counterparts.
Okay, and her stuff then, do we know what age she is now?
I think she's in her late 80s.
Does she do ceramic stuff? I think she does pumpkins a lot.
That was in bronze.
Oh, that's bronze.
Yeah, sorry, I forgot to put that in.
Yeah.
I don't think I've seen any ceramic works. It's more metals.
So that bronze there, I'm wondering, did she design that and somebody else would have made it in the bronze?
Yeah, I think she has people to do that for her now as well with her old age. She'll put it, I have an idea that someone will do it for her.
Very, very interesting. Because I'm putting this to you now, to all of you. Isn't that very interesting that she's kind of an insider, outsider,
yeah,
a choice?
Yeah.
Isn't she? She's kind of is she defiant a little bit? I wouldn't, you know.
Well, it says she's very, she likes to work in her space. Like, first she was she used to paint on people. She was very involved. She was kind of like a hippie when she was over in America, and she did a lot of like peace rallies, and she actually opened up her own LGBT club,
mm-hmm.
and she used to paint on people in there too.
Right.
She wrote a letter to Richard Nixon offering him herself to stop the Vietnam War.
Yeah, she was
kind of, it was due to her mental state as well. It's very, very outrageous. Yeah.
Have you considered bringing her style into your own work?
Probably now. I think the influence is more my fashion. I usually wear a lot of repeated patterns on my clothes. Like stripes are a lot of my wardrobe. Anything else?
Okay, well, it's inspired me to go and look her up now.
Yeah, definitely.
She's really interesting.
Yeah, okay. I think very, very good. Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Beata, and this is my presentation about oil paintings in the 19th century as my art history module from my school. So this is a little introduction, just what I'm going to talk about, the rough description, what is the oil paints, techniques, maybe you're going to get some inspiration from it, and my favorite artists. So like oil painting is the process of painting with pigments that are bound with a medium of drying oils. An artist may use several different oils in the same painting depending on a specific pigment and effects desired. The paints themselves also develop a particular consistency depending on the medium. The oil may be boiled with a resin, such as pine resin or frankincense, to create a varnish, often priced for its body and gloss. And just traditional oil painting techniques often begin with the artist sketching the subject onto the canvas with charcoal or thin paint. Oil paint is usually mixed with linseed oil. Artists create minerals, spirits, or other solvents to create a thinner, faster, or slower drying paint. A basic rule of oil paint application is fade over lean. This means that each additional layer of paint should contain more oil than the layer below to allow proper drying. If each additional layer contains less oil, the final painting will crack and peel. So this is just an example of one painting, which they finish, but they paint. I think that's very interesting. I would love to try this, but I don't know where I will get these materials from. I need to search it, but it's like dyed polymer resin, and I don't know, do you have to melt it or? Like, I haven't really looked up, but it's just abstract resin varnish painting on canvas. I like the composition and all the colors that mix together. It's really interesting. And the last one is just varnish. And here's a picture to show you the difference with the varnish and varnish removed. So the varnish removed is on the left side. So you could see how the varnish looks on the painting. And it's just like what technique you could use for application of oil paints on the canvas or on the page. And just my favorite artist from 19th century. Leonid Abramovich, he's a Russian artist. I think I like him because it's really like cheerful, like you just look at it and you smile, like he uses a lot of colors and like it's not really detailed, but I still like it. He does a lot of paintings like with rain, but I like that it's not really show the rain, just like different colors. And Vladimir Krush, he's a surrealism artist, Russian as well, from 19th century. So, like, they're very interesting for me. He is like very delicate and very detailed at paintings. And he influenced me on one of my paintings, like this one. But I didn't use oil paints for this one because I like the details. And I used like the small canvas, so like I wouldn't be so detailed with it. So I used just like thin brush strokes with acrylic paints. And it just represents like, because this piece was made for as my influence on Botanic Gardens. And it shows that like the butterflies are traveling to another place, to the Botanic Garden, like their paradise, you know, to find the nectar and all. And like those little people are just showing direction for them where to go. That's it. Okay. Thank you for your attention. Any questions?
Very nice and very, very, very unusual kind of little presentation, and quirky, and I like that. And I think you did your own piece was a pun on this other painting.
Yeah.
And that. Okay. And you kind of picked us up the poster because I was going to say to you, are you working in oil painting, but you're working in acrylics?
Mostly, yeah.
But would you like to work in
order to have? Like, I've done one painting before from level five, and I really liked it. I used the knives for it, like the knives palettes, but I don't really have time for it to try it out now because we need to work fast, I think, because of the lack of time. So I just use acrylic paints because they're drying faster. But I really like dual prints, yeah. Any other questions?
It's just generally polymer, like wax.
I don't know what polymer is.
Well, it's rubber. Yeah,
would it be like an artificial?
It's like
resin. Yeah.
Was he born? I think he's 60 now, so...
Oh, he's alive.
Yeah, yeah.
Ah, okay, I have no idea. There you go, just curious. Thanks.
Because, do we think that the one on the bottom left just does it remind us a little bit of Salvador Dali?
Yeah.
Sometimes they remind me a little bit, and then the colour on the top one is a little bit Salvador Dali, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
And very popular today, putting like one thing that's not found in one place into another. Like NCAD, like the flowers. NCAD are always doing, like, I'll take one thing and put it in a picture of another.
It's real art.
Yeah.
Put an object out of context.
Yeah.
Very
good.
Yeah, the flowers are good on the
They're
same as the
sales. You know your painting you did yourself?
Yeah.
So the background, did you draw the background in before on your own painting, before you painted it, or was it just kind of painted?
Well, I started just drawing with a boat, and then, you know, the butterflies.
Yeah.
No, I left the butterflies at the end, then I started walking with the water, but this area was like too blank for me, so I just drew the trees and the reflection to fill it up. And this corner was blank as well, so I just kind of took inspiration from him. Nearly the same, you know. But for me, like, it shows the directions for the butterflies. And like on his painting, it looks for me as like they would be in a prison, kind of. I don't know, like they're hanged on the sail. I don't know. That's my view.
Trees remind me of like Da Vinci in your paint. Remember he had the landscapes in the background of his paint. Okay.
Any other questions?
Well done.
Thank you very much.